The Bushmen of the Kalahari speak of becoming awake by developing the feeling sense. They say, once you do, you get second eyes, second ears. And you can then begin to perceive the lines, our ropes, our grids of connection between living things. Sometimes you can hear them as songs, and those songs become lines or ropes that take you somewhere. These ropes or lines are what the poet William Stafford called golden threads, and that came from a poem of William Blake's that said, I give you the end of a golden string, only wind it into a ball. It will lead you in at heaven's gate built in Jerusalem's wall. And what Blake was talking about is a touch on your feeling sense out of the ordinary. It captures your attention. You begin to follow it, winding up the thread inside you just like a ball of yarn. And it leads you in. You go past the surface into the metaphysical background of the world, into something sacred and luminous. When you approach the world with your feeling sense extended, feeling how everything that you encounter feels, from time to time, you encounter the touch of the world upon you that's out of the ordinary. The Kalahari call this a tapping. They say strong ropes connect you with everything in the universe, and when it is important to know about the other end of a rope, it will tap or pull on you. The rope is our track, they say. We feel it pulling us. When you wake up your heart and find yourself alive with good emotions, it not only makes you tremble. A number of you trembled yesterday with the tree. It not only makes you tremble, it enables you to feel the pulling of the ropes. The ultimate tracking is not achieved with the mind, but with the heart. The ancient Athenians called this a moment of notitia, the attentive noticing of the soul. It captures attention because there's something in it for you, something important to who you are. So, an essential element of this work is learning to track meaning through the world. There's certain meanings that will touch you, that will be out of the ordinary because there's something in it for you and your work in this lifetime. And those are the ones that you follow. Life becomes a pretty amazing adventure then, actually. Barbara McClintock was speaking of this when she said, I went no place that the corn did not first tell me to go. So, I mean, she was considered the greatest geneticist in the world, you know, until she made the horrible mistake of, in 1955, about she speaking at a genetics conference, and she says, the genome is a flexible organ of the cell that can change itself under instructions from the organism or the environment in which it grows. And they just hated that. She was ostracized for 20 years, okay? Not allowed to speak again. And because to them, the genome was inflexible. It was like a software program that never changed. And when she said, I went no place that the corn did not first tell me to go, they're very upset about that. They go, well, we respect her science. We just don't like her mysticism. And she said, this is not mysticism. This is actually real science. So. William Stafford, the poet, remained exquisitely sensitive to such touches upon him. He said, when you find you have a response, trust it. It has a meaning. To the alert person, a golden thread may emerge from any ordinary thing and open a doorway into the metaphysical background of the world. You never know when or where or from it will emerge. So you remain attentive to everything that's encountered, always paying close attention to how everything, even the tiniest thing, feels. Light pours through a window in a particular way. A person moves their body slightly. You enter a summer field and experience it as a quality of mind. Something inside those things brushes against you. Meaning of some sort not yet understood touches someplace deep. Ripples flow up from the depths of you and touch your conscious mind. a particular feeling engulfs you. You stop and focus your attention on what is right in front of you, the touch of a golden thread, notitia. Robert Bly describes this really brilliantly, as I just love his capacity for metaphor is unequaled. He says, following the tiny impulses through the meadow of language. For writers following golden threads, he says, it's following the tiny impulses through the meadow of language. So Stafford would be sitting, he would feel a touch, he would turn toward it and try to capture it in language. Then he would write down some part of what he was perceiving, the most immediate thing. And then he said, if I let the process go on, things will occur to me that were not at all in my mind when I started. These things, odd or trivial as they may be, are somehow connected. It's a very interesting thing. When you start following a thread, you start working with the connections that run between everything. And you start here, and all of a sudden, you're way over there, and you find somehow shoelaces are intimately related to oranges. Okay. Something just shows up in your awareness, in your thinking. Somehow the thing you're focused on has connections to things that appear unrelated, and your awareness just shifts of its own accord. The thread leads you deeper and deeper into the metaphysical background of the world. As John Muir put it, when we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it hitched to everything else in the universe. So this way of working allows us to access the threads that connect everything together. So Stafford said, any little impulse is accepted and enhanced. And Bly put it like this, he said, you keep returning to the feeling of that touch like a swallow to the barn of yielding. Isn't that nice? You keep returning to the feeling of that touch like a swallow to the barn of yielding. Okay. Another way to put it is, there's a luminosity all things possess inside them. So, yes. You keep returning to the feeling of that touch like a swallow to the barn of yielding. Because one of the neat things about that line is it says you can't impose your will on what's happening. You sit down at its feet and become its servant, its devotee, and you then be in relationship with it and follow where it leads, right? Like a swallow to the barn of yielding. So Basho, the Japanese poet, said, your poetry issues of its own accord when you and the object become one, when you have plunged deep enough into it to see something like a hidden glimmering there. Okay. And another way to put it is, there's a luminosity inside things. All things possess it. And Bly has another great line. He says, the owl's dark eyelids cover a luminosity that our reason cannot grasp. The owl's dark eyelids cover a luminosity our reason cannot grasp. Because of our enhanced sensitivity working with heart field and feeling touch like that, we notice when that luminosity emerges more strongly into our awareness, and then we begin to follow that particular expression of it through the world. All of my work has come out of exactly that process. All of the books I've written, everything like that, all the things I've found. The focus is totally on the feeling of the touch. Nothing else is in your mind, you just follow it. And Stafford says, only the golden string knows where it's going. Okay. And the role for the writer or reader is one of following, not imposing. Only the thread knows where it's going. Okay. Golden threads are an experience of the extensive interconnections that touch the nodes of meaning we know of as physical objects. Gregory Bateson said, the world is a vast network or matrix of interlocking message material. The world is a vast network or matrix of interlocking message material, and our feeling touch allows us to connect ourselves to the semantic underpinnings of the world and follow those connections. We experientially move into the network of interlocking message material. Okay. The Kalahari said, Tell your people they have to wake up twice in the morning. First, they have to wake up in the morning and get out of bed. Then they must awaken their heart. They must walk out of the bedrock of objects and materialism and into a spiritual world guided by the felt lines of relationships that hold everything together. At that point, the ropes, rather than the objects they connect, are primary. They become the most important and most real. So Bradford Keeney, who wrote about this, he said, when the Bushmen say they own something, it means not only that they own the feeling for it. See, it's really interesting. He doesn't go, they own the physical object. They own the feeling for it, right? Not only do they own the feeling for it, but also that the feeling has transmitted its essence, its complex nexus of relationships into their very being. And in the process, we become the other, whether a friend, butterfly, redwood, forest, giraffe, or seahorse, through our intensely felt union with it. But its complex nexus of relationships is also in there, and we become aware of all of the things to which it's connected. Anyone who begins going deeper into the metaphysical background of the world will experience this. It will encounter those threads of connection. And the experience is widespread. It's limited to no culture, no time. Artists of all kinds encounter them, including real scientists. Science is an art, you know. It's not a science. Stafford deeply analyzed the process like Goethe, and his poems all came out of it, and he found deeper truths and captured them in language. So here's one of his poems. I think it's one of the greatest poems ever written. He says, if you don't know what kind of person I am, and I don't know what kind of person you are, a pattern that others made may prevail in the world. And following the wrong God home, we may miss our star. For there is many a small betrayal in the mind, a shrug that lets the fragile sequence break, sending with shouts the horrible errors of childhood storming out to play through the broken dike. And as elephants parade, holding each elephant's tail, but if one wanders, the circus won't find the park. I call it cruel, and maybe the root of all cruelty, to know what occurs but not recognize the fact. And so I appeal to a voice, to something shadowy, a remote, important region in all who talk. Though we could fool each other, we should consider lest the parade of our mutual life get lost in the dark. For it is important that awake people be awake. Our breaking line may discourage them back to sleep. The signals we give, yes, our no, our maybe, should be clear. The darkness around us is deep. Isn't that a great line? For it is important that awake people be awake. Our breaking line may discourage them back to sleep. The signals we give, yes, our no, our maybe, should be clear. The darkness around us is deep. Is that a great poem? That's magnificent. William Stafford. I don't know. I didn't write down the title, I forget. What? That's right, it's a ritual to read to each other. Thank you. Some threads that you encounter are very subtle. When you get used to this kind of perception, you can feel the tapping as soon as it touches you. And then you follow where it leads you. Some golden threads take you on journeys that last years and years, decades, lifetimes. McClintock spent much of her lifetime working with corn and letting it take her deeper in. Okay. Following the tiny touches on her perceptual feeling sense, as she put it, you let the material tell you where to go, and it tells you at every step what the next step has to be. Other journeys last just a few moments or perhaps a day, like this one. Okay. So I was visiting David Hoffman in California, and so I was at his house, and I happened to mention I was going to be writing a book on fermentation. He says, oh, have you read this book? And he gives me this book called Pharmacopoeia by Dale Pendle. I said, no. And so he leaves, and I sit down to read it, and I become engrossed. So about 4 hours later, he comes back, and I'm still there reading. And I said, this is magnificent. And he goes, I know, Dale, would you like to meet him? And I said, yes, I would. So he said, great. I'll call him up. And he calls him up and he says, great, Dale can meet us tomorrow. We'll go up to his place. I thought, fantastic. So I wake up the next morning and we have our tea and stuff and we get up and we're walking out crunching across the gravel in his driveway. And he goes, oh, you know, my car's in the shop. Can we use yours? And just when he said that, I felt this funny feeling. And I said, okay. So we get in his car, and we start driving down the road. We're in Sebastopol, California, and we're driving along, and he goes, oh, you know, there's a couple of stops I need to make. I was like, okay. All right, so I just kind of like realize we're going to have an adventure now, right? So we go to this this natural food store, and we pull up in front and park, and we go in, and David says, wait here, I have to go talk to somebody. I'll be right back. And so off he goes, and I'm standing there, and there's like, you know, some baristas there making cappuccinos and stuff. And so I walk up and I go, could you make me a breve, which is in America half and half. You don't really have half and half here. You have either cream or milk, but anyway, it's quite yummy. And so the baristas are standing behind, and they're talking to each other. And so one starts making my, you know, drink, and she's talking to the other one as she's doing it, and she says, you know, I went to see that body worker that you told me to go see, and the woman said, yeah, great, and he says, yeah, you were right, he's amazing. As soon as he put his hands on my body, everything just changed. She goes, yeah, I told you, you know, and so then I get my drink, and I'm standing there sipping it. David comes back, we get in the car, and we drive along. He goes, oh, stop here. So we pull up in front of a record store. They used to have record stores then. And we pull up in, I don't know if you ever in a used record store, but they're rather grim places mostly. I mean, the walls were painted that white, that's so white, it's almost blue, you know? And the floor had this crappy linoleum on it, and all of the bins were made out of plywood, stained that horrible walnut color in the States that seemed to cover the whole country for a while. And there's all these people flipping through albums with these glazed expressions on their face, you know. And David, when I walk in, and David says, wait here, I got to go talk to this guy. He goes, but you know, you might enjoy those photographs on the back wall. So I go back to the photographs, and they're framed terribly, in the cheapest possible frames, but they're pictures of the Beatles and Jimi Hendrix and Eric Clapton and all of these people, you know. And so I'm standing there looking at them, and behind me, there's these two guys talking as they flip through the records, and one of them says to the other, you know, I went to that body worker that you told me about, and the guy's amazing. You know, he put his hands on my body, and everything just changed, and I'm sitting there going, I'm never coming back to Northern California. This happens every time. You know, so David comes back, and we're standing there, and he goes, yeah, my dad took all of those. He was the Beatles' official photographer. And then he points to him, and he goes, you know, that one gave me my first drugs. And I was like, really? Really? So.
Did you say his name?
So we get back in the car, and then there's these errands and errands and errands and errands, you know. And so finally it's time to go to Dale's house. And so we get to this place, it's up in the mountains, and we start going up this horrible road. It was put in terribly, and the water running down has made it really rutted. So as we're driving up, and it's one of those things, you've probably been on, where the ruts are slightly too wide for the tires. So you're going up and you get sucked into one side and then sucked into the other side, and we're being battered around in this thing. And we're going up this hill, you know, it's very steep. And we get up and there's this kind of red house on stilts over to the left, and he goes, "That's where Dale lives. That was Jack London's cook's house." You know, we'll go there in a minute. I have to go up here. So we go up to the very top and we park and we get out, you know, and this door opens. It's this big house, and down at the bottom, this door opens, and this guy, he's very tall, about 6'3", with these most amazing eyebrows, you know, and he walks out. He's carrying this big glass container with this brilliant, brilliant emerald green liquid in there, and he walks up and he goes, "You want some absinthe?" And I said, "Yes, I do." And then David goes, "I don't like alcohol, and besides, I got to talk to this guy, so I'll see you later," and off he goes, right? So we walk down the road, you know, him talking and chatting about stuff, and he's carrying stuff. He goes, "It's almost ready," you know, and so we get in, and we walk up the steps to his house, up, and we get up to the door, and there's that sign that says, "Demons welcome here," you know, and I go, and he goes, turns out they already had the address. So we go in and sit down, and he goes back and adds little alchemical things to it, you know. And then he brings out these tall glasses, you know, and he puts an absinthe spoon on the top. It looks just like a weird fork, but they call it an absinthe spoon, and a little sugar cube. And then he pours, you know, a 1 ounce shot of the absinthe in, and very slowly pours water through the sugar cube, really slow, till it dissolves. And he goes, "Here." You know, we start drinking and we're just talking. And then he goes, "You want some more?" And I notice we've consumed it all. And I said, "Yes." So he pours some more. And about halfway through the next one, we both start doing spontaneous poetry readings. So I give him one of mine, you know. Let's see. He goes, "How often have I walked in deep forest, searching for traces of the path that lay concealed beneath my feet?" Right? And then he goes, and then he gives me one of his, you know, and then I give him one of mine. We're going back and forth and getting deeper into this, and it's just fantastic, you know. And, you know, so I'm sitting there, I'm noticing the wood of the table has this most marvelous, luminous quality. And I'm going, you know, this is incredible. Why did they make this illegal? This is completely wrong. Look at that. And, you know, and I'm talking, I'm noticing that the wood grain has a lot of similarity to the poetry that we're sharing. It's like, oh, this is fantastic, you know, what wonderful stuff. And so then about then, I hear some steps on the stairs, and David comes in, and he sits down, and he takes a look at Dale as Dale's doing this poetry, and me responding, and then Dale, and then me, and he goes, "Give me some." So he makes David some, and David's trying to catch up, you know, because he knows we found a marvelous world, and he wants to join us as quickly as he possibly can. You know, and so we're sitting there in this marvelous glow, sharing all this stuff, and everything's quite luminous, you know, and we're just having a marvelous time. And then I begin hearing this sound. And I look out, and I see this head coming up the steps, you know, outside the window, and it's this guy, he looks like a marionette. He's coming up the steps like that. And he opens the door and he comes in, and unfortunately there's a chair, the only chair is right next to me that's empty, right? And he sits down, and he has the most and deepest blue eyes you ever saw, and he leans over and he looks at me and he goes, "I died, you know." No, spare me. I don't want to have an experience with Northern California today. No. "And that's when the angel came." Oh God. No, please, I don't want to. But I'm like trapped. because I'm in like this timeless moment and I can't seem to do anything. I'm just stuck, like, you know, in this kind of childlike wonder state. And I'm looking at him and it's like he's somebody that maybe has had a, like a right brain stroke or left brain stroke or something. And he's like, you know, totally like a little infant. We're both in this just being born infant stage. And I'm falling deeper and deeper in his eyes. And that's when the angel came. No, help me. I can't think of anything to do. I'm just trapped right there, held in the moment, you know. You know, and I see him, and it's like he's gathering his energy for another run at me, you know, and it's like, no, but I can't do anything. And then he goes, I was driving down our road, and I lost control of the car, and I wrecked against the trees at the bottom, and I broke that part of my neck, the same one that Christopher Reeve did, and I died on the operating table. But that's when the angel came, and it told me exactly what I needed to do to be able to walk again. And I did it, and I think I'm doing pretty good, don't you? And I had to admit, yes, given all that, you're doing pretty good. And he said, you know, I've been a body worker for a long time. But when I put my hands on the people, they just change. A little goosebump index again, huh? A little friction. So, and I thought, yeah, this is an amazing day. So, those things happen all the time, and you never know when they're going to emerge or what shape they're going to take. But as soon as David said, my car's in the shop, let's take yours, I knew, and I felt that funny feeling. I knew we were in for an amazing adventure. Feels good, doesn't it? Yeah. As you can see, this is a very different way of life than what we've learned in school. Right? A very different way of gathering information about the world and our place in it than reductionism. Yet the knowledge found there generally will surpass the knowledge found by reductive approaches because it's more accurate to the world itself. And it naturally has empathy within it. If we wish to not be careless with the world, we need to care. I mean, it's so funny, the word careless means without care. And as soon as you don't have care, you become careless. It's almost the definition of reductive approaches because they remove care from the work. And I love this thing Joan Halifax, the Buddhist teacher, said once. She said, as soon as we remove rattlesnake, mountain lion, poison ivy from wild ecosystems, they immediately begin to degrade because human beings no longer have to be careful when they enter them. Because those things force a kind of awareness. So to do this really entails the use of the heart as a perceiving organ. It allows us to experience the thing that's more than the sum of the parts. So for a lot of people in the West, it takes hallucinogens or some incredible experience to begin to bring them out of that kind of reductive embedding. So I'm going to go into a bit into sensory gating channels because that moment taking the absinthe with Dale and David, my sensory gating channels opened quite a bit in that moment. But they can open in all different kinds of times and all different kinds of ways. All of us have had moments when we step outside the normal perceptual framework that we live in most of the time. I mean, all of you must have sometime like in the afternoon when the sunlight begins to change and it gets that almost golden luminous kind of quality to it and everything just seems like it's bathed in some sort of magical honey or something and you just feel that kind of shift. In those moments, you change your perceptual state. Your sensory gating channels begin to open. So it's a natural thing, a part of our birthright, as human beings. So when I talk about an early one of mine, I was I was at my grandparents' house. And my grandfather, this is the only intimate moment we ever shared in the entire time we knew each other, but it was really magical. So I'm like, must have been 9 or 10 or something like that, and I'm going outside to play. I'm up on the second floor of the house, and I walk by his office, and just something catches my attention, and I just sort of stop and turn toward it. I don't know why, but for some reason, I just got caught up and pulled into this whole different frame of reference. The light was coming in the windows in that really incredible, luminous, magical way, and it just caught my sense of wonder and pulled me in there. It glowed in a way I'd never noticed before, as if everything in the room were living stained glass, and it was just luminous from inside of itself and shimmering. Time slowed very slow and began to stop. It seemed I had as much time as I needed to perceive each and everything in the room, everything that was happening. Every sound was vivid, and the silence itself took on a kind of sound that I'd never noticed before. I could hear my grandfather's breathing, the rustle of his papers on his desk as he moved his hands, the slight rustle of the drapes behind him, my own breath going slowly in and out. And held in this moment of wonder, I looked at my grandfather, and I could tell he was held in that moment too, both of us caught up in this magical moment together, as if I had new eyes and was seeing the world for the first time. And I could feel this tremendous caring coming out of everything toward myself, toward him, toward both of us. And in that moment just seemed to go on and on and on and on. And then, like it always does, it just sort of dissipated and began to pass. And there was this look that passed between the two of us, acknowledging what we'd both experienced, but of course we didn't have any words to talk about it. And so we chatted a bit about inconsequential things, and then I went outside to play, but I never forgot it. You know, childhood is filled with moments like this, always, and they remain inside of us like seeds. Awaiting only the right moment to come again into our awareness and begin to grow. I don't know why that's funny, but it is. So, of course, nobody in my family ever talked about experiences like that. They remained invisible to them, whether they had them or not. And it took me a long time to find later in life that these experiences are extremely common. They're just not talked about in Western cultures. And there's a reason for that, you know. You must not extend awareness further than your culture wants it to go. So years later, I came across these lines by William Stafford where he said, "I was as if in a shell that glowed. All the big, dim reading room became more itself and had more meaning because of what I was writing. The alcove at the East End, where the literature browsing books were a favorite of mine, was darker and more velvety. My steps walking back to the boarding house to work were ritual steps, feet placed carefully on the storybook world." And Albert Hoffman, who said, "One enchantment of that kind which I experienced in childhood has remained remarkably vivid in my memory. It happened on a May morning. I've forgotten the year, but I can still point to the exact spot where it occurred. On a forest path above Baden, Switzerland, as I strolled through the freshly greened woods filled with birdsong and lit up by the morning sun, all at once, everything appeared in an uncommonly clear light. Was this something I had simply failed to notice before? Was I suddenly discovering the spring forest as it actually looked? It shone with the most beautiful radiance, speaking to the heart as though it wanted to encompass me in its majesty. I was filled with an indescribable sensation of joy, oneness, and blissful security. Manuel Cordova Rios said, as my glance wandered in the treetops, I became aware of undreamed beauty in the details of the textures of the leaves, stems, and branches. Every leaf, as my attention settled on it, seemed to glow with a greenish golden light. Unimaginable detail of structure showed a nearby bird song, the irregular arpeggios of the seven songs floated down, exquisite and shimmering. The song was almost visible. Time seemed suspended. There was only now, and now was infinite. I could separate the individual notes of the bird song and savor each in its turn. As the notes of the song were repeated, I floated in a sensation that seemed somewhere between smelling an elusive, intoxicating fragrance and tasting a delicate ambrosia. Albert Hoffman talks about these experiences this way. He says, there are experiences most of us are hesitant to speak about because they do not conform to everyday reality. They defy rational explanation. These are not particular external occurrences, but rather events of our inner lives, which are generally dismissed as figments of the imagination and barred from our memory. Suddenly, the familiar view of surroundings is transformed in a strange, delightful way. It appears to us in a new light, takes on special meaning. Such experiences can be light and fleeting as a breath of air, or it can imprint itself deeply upon us. Most of us are taught that these kind of experiences are not important. They're a figment of our imagination, so we learn to hide or ignore them. You must not extend awareness further than your culture wants it to go. You get what I mean here by that? There's a cultural injunction. So these kind of experiences belong within the world of holistic perception. Using heart perception, it's core to it. Everybody you read that used that kind of perception, whether it's Goethe, Barbara McClintock, Albert Einstein, they all have moments like this continually throughout their lives that they talk about. All of us have access to that. All of us can do it. We walk in a forest and we come upon suddenly a great tree or an ancient rock formation and we're caught up for a moment in something outside our human world. We catch a glimpse of the metaphysical background of the world, and always, every time, there's a certain kind of feeling that accompanies it. The root of it is always feeling. Robert Bly talks about the experience when he says, as we read Thoreau's work, especially his prose, we slowly become aware of a light in and around the squirrel, the ant, the woodchuck, the hawk, that belongs to them and not to the eyes observing or the brain producing words. The light in and around the squirrel that belongs to them. That's what these people were experiencing and talking about. I suspect that's what brought many of you here for this week. For that is what this week is about. These experiences occur when what Blake called the doors of perception open and the metaphysical background of the world begins flowing into our perceptual sensing. Heart perception is always part of this, but it always involves an expansion of sensory gating channels, an opening of the doors of perception. Those initial accounts by Stafford and Hoffman, you might say, are the opening of the doors. But the experiences can go much deeper. You can actually go through the doors into the metaphysical background of the world and immerse yourself inside it. So here's one of my experiences about that. So, just out of the blue, we bought that land up behind Boulder, behind the Flatirons of Boulder, Colorado, up at 9,000 feet. And just out of the blue, oddly enough, about 2 weeks after we moved up there, this thought kind of came into my head out of nowhere that says, you need to learn all the medicinal plants up here. So I went, oh, okay. And so I found an herbalist that was incredibly poor in town, and I said, I will give you $100 if you will come up here and walk this land with me and tell me all these herbs. And she said, oh, okay, great, great idea. So the next day we began walking, and it's like, was amazingly diverse. And we walk around, and she goes, oh, that plant, that's osha. Oh, the root of that's really good for intestinal cramping. And I said, really? Oh, that's fascinating. Great. And so off she goes. And 2 weeks later, I had intestinal cramping. Okay, but it's not like you're thinking. It's a cross between, oh, appendicitis and kidney stones. So if you don't know what you do in a moment like that, you scream, you fall on the floor, you curl into a ball, and you pray for God to kill you. And if God doesn't kill you, you hate God. Now, the interesting thing about hating God is Gandhi said, you know, the man who loves God will attain enlightenment in 20 years. The man who hates God will do it in 2. So then you crawl and you hate God, you're laying there curled into a ball, and then it passes, and your body is all like limp spaghetti noodles, and you sweat copiously. And if you're me, you probably go, huh, it's nothing. And so then, you know, but the thing is, it happened about 2 weeks later. Again, and this time I knew it was cancer. Because as I mentioned, I could only have 2 diseases, cancer or nothing. So I'd sit around the house, and my little son would walk by, and I'd go, huh. I'll never get to see him grow up. My wife would walk by, and I'd go, huh. And finally, after a few days, she goes, what? And I said, I didn't want to tell you, but it's cancer. And she goes, again? But, you know, after a few days, nothing else happened, so I realized that I was overreacting. It was really nothing. So, well, this went on for a while, and I went to doctors, and that whole thing's humorous, too, but I'll skip that part. And but they wanted to do exploratory surgery, and there was no way I was going to do that. So I went home, and I started eating. I dug up this root, and I started eating the root. And the next time the attack happened, it was only about half as severe. Right? And the next time half as severe again. And the next time half as severe again. I was like, oh, this is magnificent. So I became incredibly politically active. You know, I was running around Boulder going, sign this petition. They're trying to steal our herbal medicines from us. You know, and people would see me coming and they'd cross the street, you know. We all have to go through fanaticism on our way, you know, don't we, sooner or later. But the other thing that was really cool is that when I took the plant, I could feel the plant helping my body, but I felt a living being inside me, just like that puppy I talked about. It was different, but it was this living being in there, like they had the kind of energy talking to me. And I thought, oh, this is fascinating. Such a thing has never happened to me before. This is really interesting. And so I decided I wanted to have that experience with every plant that grew all around us on the 40 acres where we were living. And so for the next 7 years, I would spend, you know, hours and hours and hours every day sitting with the plants and working with them. About 4 hours, 2 to 4 hours every day, mostly more like 4. And so, you know, I was doing that. And so one day I was sitting with this plant called usnea. It's a lichen that grows on trees. And I'm sitting there, you know, just really liking it and loving it and everything. And all of a sudden I just sort of went into like this kind of dream state. And as Manuel Cordova Rios would say, on the screen of my inner vision, right, I saw this young man really far away walking toward me. Right? And as he got closer, I could see his hair was that lichen. Right? And then as he gets really close, I see, even though he looked young, he's got these amazingly ancient lines around his eyes. He's really, really old. And he gets up really close to me and he looks in my eyes and he goes, you've been sitting with me in a good way. And I just wanted to tell you that the reason why usnea works for human lungs as medicine is because it's lungs for the medicine of the planet, the trees. I just wanted you to know that. Usnea. U-S-N-E-A. Usnea. Lichen. Lichen.
A lichen.
Says, I just wanted you to know that. And then he turned and began walking away. Kind of came back to myself and I went, wow, that's really cool. You know, but I was kind of starting to reach the limit of my, you know, I'm as liberal as the next guy, but I'm starting to get out of my comfort zone, you know. It's like, how do I, because I had no skills for talking about something like that then. But what's the interesting thing is, for the first time, it occurred to me the plants are doing something, and they have been doing something for hundreds of millions of years besides pining away for our emergence. That the usne is actually medicine for the trees. And the usne is an amazing thing. It's a mixture of a fungi and an algae. The green on the outside is the algae, and it's very antibacterial, and the fungi on the inside is very immune stimulating and immune potentiating. So it grows on the tree, and it's, you know, the fungal mycelium network goes into the bark, and it exchanges, as the tree gets under stress, it pulls those medicinal substances into it to help it deal with disease. These kind of experiences are not unusual. Indigenous medicine people talked about them all the time. They said when a person needed a plant for healing, it would stand up in the forest and begin calling to them. Like that story about Angelica. See, I didn't tell her where we were going. She's just walking along, and then it reached out and touched her. And she's pulled to it. And so I had a direct experience of gathering knowledge directly from the plant medicine. For the first time. And nobody at that point understood that they acted as medicine for the trees. And ultimately that led eventually over a long period of time to my book, Lost Language of Plants, where I talk in there about how plants exchange medicinal substances in ecosystems to keep everybody healthy. So then indigenous people said their knowledge of plant medicines came in dreams and visions, or the plants themselves told them. So to understand better, I went to the University of Colorado library, and in the basement, I found all these books that hadn't been checked out since like 1920. And they were anthropological texts, first-person interviews with indigenous healers, right? And I'd carry these massive things up, and dust would fly off, and they'd have to enter them into the computer system because nobody'd read them in a long time. And their stories were absolutely phenomenal. They were really clear. Our knowledge of the plant medicines did not come from linear cause and effect processes. The plant told us. But invariably, when the Western writers were talking about it, they go, isn't it sad? They're so superstitious, unchristian savages. They have to make this stuff up. But the weird thing is, it's like I was reading accounts from all around the planet. So it's like, oh yeah, they're just screwing with us, man. These guys got together and got their story straight before we showed up, just so they can screw with us, right? But if you're a real scientist, you'd go, well, here it's there. Then you have to go, there's something else going on besides linear reductive cause and effect stories. And all of the scientists that look back at that, they say, oh, they did it from cause and effect, from linear, you know, they just figured it out that way. And they say, if you think about it any other way, you're anthropomorphizing, you're romanticizing. You know, my response is like, I read this one book, The Way, what's this, Goldsmith?
Teddy Goldsmith,
and he had one great word in the book, mechanomorphizing. He said, au contraire, my friends, they are mechanomorphizing, projecting onto nature a mechanical nature, right? That word is worth thousands of dollars. And so, I mean, because basically, think about it, we've got a lot more in common with a plant than we do a clock or a car. So we tend to pass over these kind of comments. You know, if you really get into reading what people write about older cultures, most of it's made up. You'll see the word probably, likely, you know, and all of this stuff all in through there. They just make this stuff up. You have to really think about it, though. Most of us just go, oh, okay. Because we've all learned by cause and effect. You know, like, everybody learns the same way. Don't cut with the knife in this direction, right? Or about matches. This is the way we learn. You get a, you know, you get those big wooden matches. You have those here in England? They allow you to have those? Health and safety people? You know? So then you light the match and you go like this to get it going. But pretty soon you're like, holy shit! So you learn that you burn yourself. You know, we learn from stuff like that all of the time. So they make up. Well, they learned the uses of these plant medicines like that. But you have to really think about it. Okay? So let's say you've got the first guy ever in the history of the earth and human beings that cuts the shit out of himself, right? And he's bleeding horribly. And he goes, hey, I'll put a plant on it. Now that's a huge leap, but let's skip over that. So he goes, I'll put a plant on it. So he goes in and gets some grass and he puts it on there, nothing, right? Gets a cherry leaf, nothing. You know, and he's really bleeding out. This is bad. So he's going through the forest. He's trying all these different things. And he comes upon yarrow. And he picks some yarrow, first bruising it so that the juice will liberally enter the wound. And then he puts it on the thing. The bleeding stops. And he goes home and tells his family. Most amazing thing happened. He goes home and tells the family. And then they tell everybody else. And thus, the knowledge of yarrow enters the world pharmacopoeia. Okay? I don't think so. Everybody would have died out before that happened. Okay, but you know, it gets even more twitchy when you bring up cedar. Every culture that has cedar uses it for the same thing, to ward off malevolent spirits. So you see, we're already in trouble, aren't we, with the reductive trial and error thing? Because you have to start here. A guy's walking through the forest, minding his own business, when suddenly a malevolent spirit shows up. And it's like the guy's really scared, as anybody would be, and he begins racing through the forest, and he gets some yarrow and holds it up. Nothing! Right? And he tries grass, you know, cherry bark, everything. He's like, stop it, stop it! You know, but it's really on his ass, it's really going to get him, and finally he gets to a cedar tree, and it dissipates. The malevolent energy dissipates. Cedar wards off malevolent energy and spirit. So he goes back to his family and tells them, and thus the knowledge of cedar enters everything. That's what the reductive scientists would have us believe, right? It's absurd. It's absurd. So visionary experiences such as these are moments when the heart field completely synchronizes with an outside field, and there's this massive download of information from the plant through your heart into your brain. And at that moment, it's without the intermediary of language. You're getting direct experience of the medicine of the plant. Okay? Now it comes in as this meaning burst, and what happens is your brain, in order to work with it, it pulls stuff from all of its stores of memories and experiences to encapsulate it in a way you can have it as a memory, right? So it'll pull this picture from here, this sound from there, this taste from there. It'll pull stuff from any cultural myths you might have been given, stuff from your culture, stuff you've read, anything like that. And then you get this kind of burst that you can... So that stuff that happened to me, that's how, with the usnea, that's how my mind created a memory so that I could keep the experience inside me. So those kind of experiences exist on a spectrum. They begin with the light around the squirrel. They deepen with usnea. And they go deeper yet. You can go so deep you're literally immersed in the metaphysical background of the world in a place where human markers do not exist at all. Okay. These experiences are not only natural to human beings, they're natural to every life form on this planet. Every life form on the planet has visionary experiences. Okay. Anybody can do it. We do it every day to differing degrees. We just don't notice that we do. It's a matter of just honing it as an intentional skill. There's no need for mystical masters. our years of study in an ashram. Or as Kabir said, eating nothing but vegetables and legs winding around your own neck. Which is a fascinating image, isn't it? If I could be up here with a carrot and my legs are up here, I'm sitting there going, and then what you do? So, I had an image of me going, now for our next exercise, we have to get your legs around your neck. And everybody, well, it's hilarious to me, but you know. Now, this is the oldest form of science that there is, okay? All indigenous people were the best scientists in the world. They were natural philosophers. And these experiences are dependent on sensory gating channels opening more widely. Now, interestingly, when I first went to California, I ended up living, as I mentioned, with this guy named Mark Geyer, a psychopharmacologist, and he and his friends had been at the University of Iowa getting their master's degree, and they'd been getting pharmaceutically pure LSD from Switzerland that they were supposed to be giving to the chimpanzees in there, but they were actually all injecting it themselves and just having a great time. So, and it was just really exciting, so I'm living there. But he's one of the guys that, oddly enough, came up with the term sensory gating channels. And Blake said, if the doors of perception were cleansed, everything would appear to man as it is infinite. For man has closed himself up till he sees through narrow chinks of his cavern. Huh. Aldous Huxley said there are things known and things unknown, and in between are the doors of perception. So, of course, all of these psychopharmacologists that have been getting stoned out of their mind for years on LSD, they all knew about the doors of perception, but you know, they couldn't really call it that, because then somebody would immediately go, you know, we're here to discuss real science, not, you know, some mythical earth being like Gaia. They didn't like it, it's too poetic, so they changed it to sensory gating channels, right? Now, one of the things I love, I really am disappointed George Carlin died, because he was so great. Now, there's been this weird thing happening to language for a long time. They're taking the life out of it. So, now, what's interesting is during the Civil War, do you know what they called the thing that happened to soldiers in the United States in the Civil War? The thing that happened to them, we would call it post-traumatic stress disorder, but you know what they called it then? Soldier's heart. Isn't that incredible? You feel the impact of that immediately? Okay. Soldier's heart. In World War I, they called it shell shock. Right? You still got an impact of it, but it's a little more removed. Soldier's heart, shell shock. World War II, it was battle fatigue. They're just tired. You know? And then Vietnam, post-traumatic stress disorder. Now it's PTSD, and everybody's got it. I fell off my bike, I have PTSD. A man looked at me cruelly, I have PTSD, you know. But it's like, think about it, if I say PTSD, it doesn't convey anything, has no emotional tone to it. Even post-traumatic stress disorder doesn't have any tone to it. Battle fatigue, at least you get like that, shell shock, soldier's heart. So they called it sensory gating channels. Now, Blake was describing an actual dynamic. He didn't need any scientific study or to become a PhD to understand this. He described an actual thing quite well, as a matter of fact. We're immersed in this sea of meaning encoded in sensory bits all of the time, and our neural system shuts most of it out. It gates it out. So a lot of the exercises I'm doing this week is playing with opening sensory gating channels from a lot of different points of view or different approaches. But when you go into those states where you feel that duende and stuff, things expand. Your sensory gating channels open for a while. Heart field work is just part of this. So see, we exist in a sensory sea. And it's all coming in through our sensory receptors. And the amount of data within the sensory inflows is massive. We just don't usually notice it. So now if you just look around the room, pay attention to all of the visual impulses that exist, the different shades of color, the different textures, the play of shadow and light, see? And if you focus, like even on some of these stones that are holding the corners of the window wells, in any of them, it doesn't matter. Look at the incredible range of coloration that's in there. And as you focus more closely and you just really get deeper into it, you can see even more shades, right? But until I brought it up to your awareness, you weren't noticing that, right? You had gated it out because you'd were focused over here, so your neural net's gating it out. The fascinating thing is all of those sensory bits are going in to your system all of the time, whether you notice it or not. Literally everything is being taken in. Every sound, every smell, every taste, every feeling, every visual, every sound, everything, the entire thing is going in. So just looking like that, what happened is you begin to open sensory gating channels so you could notice more visual phenomena. So if you look at something, that light's okay. So look at like that lamp and just focus on it visually and just begin noticing the colors of it, the shape of it, the texture of it. How does it feel? Okay, as soon as I said that, there was this intimation of mood or feeling that occurred. You might not be able to exactly say what it is, but as soon as I said that and you felt that burst, your sensory gating channels that work with feeling open more widely, okay? You begin taking more and more of the feeling field you're immersed in all of the time. Everything that is in here has a feeling dimension to it. And that's going in all of the time as well. But your neural network is reducing the amount of incoming data that reaches conscious awareness, and it does it to prevent sensory overload. Okay. That's one of the problems that happens with people diagnosed as schizophrenic. Their sensory gating doesn't shut down. They take it in all of the time. They really do experience things other people can't perceive, okay, but that are really there. Their interpretation is usually highly problematical, however. So if we perceived all of this all of the time, we would begin to experience a kind of cognitive fragmentation. Our conscious mind would become overloaded, so our neural network gates or shuts it out. It's like there's a series of reducing valves at various places in the brain along the neural network, each one shuts out a little bit of it. And each part of that neural net is highly intelligent and aware, okay? Those parts of the brain are self-organized systems. They're using specific filtering parameters to analyze what's coming in terms of importance. Filters are made from your software, your evolutionary software, the functions of that part of the brain, and also what your task set is. Like, as you're listening to me, that becomes a thing you focus your awareness on, so other stuff is more gated out. The incoming data is compared with the filtering parameters, things that are deemed important are allowed through, everything else is kept out. The thing that's important to understand is everything is getting in there. Human beings perceive everything all the time. They just don't know they do, for the most part. So to get an idea of this, I think this is seriously cool. There's people that have a certain kind of blindness that's caused by damage to the part of the brain where the images reach consciousness, the primary visual cortex, okay? So what happens is their eyes work fine. They actually can see. and it goes into their neural net, and all of their neural net sees, but at the last little moment where it gets from the last part of the neural net to conscious awareness, that part's broken, right? And they can't see. But the thing is, they are seeing all the time anyway, so they can actually learn to move through a room of objects without running into anything, because they begin to trust the deeper parts of the neural network. It's called blind sight. Isn't that fascinating? It just blows my mind to know that they can trust the unconscious part to see for them. You must understand that nothing is what you've taken it to be. So, and it's interesting, I just love what Blake said. He said, if the doors of perception were cleansed, everything would appear to man as it is infinite. For man has closed himself up till he sees through narrow chinks of his cavern. I mean, it's a perfect description of sensory gating. So we can learn to open and close down sensory gating as much as we wish. Okay? You can choose to simply open it very wide. That's what holistic perception and science does. They learn to open sensory gating very wide in certain ways. We can close it down. It can be under our control. And the thing is, every living organism on Earth has sensory gating exactly the same way we do. Sensory gating predates the emergence of our species tremendously. And one of the major mechanisms Gaia has for opening sensory gating is hallucinogens. Okay? They've existed on Earth a very, very long time, and they perform one specific function, and that is they open sensory gating very wide. And when sensory gating opens very wide, you can perceive more of the metaphysical background, more of the meanings that are going on. And it also depatterns your behavior. It allows you to innovate behaviors outside of your habituated patterns. And that happens with every organism. The opening of gating channels gives rise to these experiences. So here's another example of it. Okay, so there's this young girl, Lakota Indian, in the United States, in the Dakotas, and her parents are dead, and she lives with her grandfather and grandmother. Okay. So her grandfather is a medicine man with plants. He's a plant vegetalista. And he's learned for a long time to look and see if any of the members of the tribe happen to be showing any gifts in that direction. And he notices his little granddaughter is. So he decides to take her out in the world and begin working with her about it and see if he's really accurate about this. He's pretty sure. So she's 4, and they get up and they have breakfast one morning, and he gets up and he gets his digging stick and his medicine bag, and he puts the digging stick in it, and he says, "Little one, let's go for a walk now." Oh, and she's excited. She loves her grandfather. It's great. Oh, she can tell it's something special. And so they go out and they start to walk off, and she looks back and her two brothers are playing, you know, some stupid game that boys play. And she looks at him and she's like, "You know, I get to go with grandfather, you know." And so they're out walking, and it's like in the spring, and it's like these rolling hills, and there's these beautiful yellow flowers everywhere. So they walk way, way, way out. And then they get to this one little hill, and the grandfather says, "Okay, little one, sit down here." And so she sits down, and right in front of one of those flowers. And he says, "I want you to be with this flower, and then when I come back, I want you to tell me everything about it." She goes, "Okay," and off he goes. So she looks at the flower really close. She sees it's about this tall, has kind of gray-green leaves and little yellow petals. And this takes about 2 minutes. And then she happens to notice there's an ant highway right next to it. I don't know if you know that ants make highways. And if you're 4 years old and you see an ant highway, it's pretty darn impossible not to accidentally drop something on the highway. So she did that for a while and watched the ants like struggle to get these little rocks and everything out of the way, you know, make a little chasm as the case may be. And then they work with that to fix that, you know, and this entertained her for quite a while. Then she noticed a butterfly and she gets up and she's like following the butterfly. And then she lays down and rolls down the hill for a while, lays on her back and looks at the clouds, just has a great time. Then she sees her grandfather coming back, so she brushes herself off, goes back to the plant, sits down and waits. And he comes up and he goes, "Little one, what did you see while I was gone?" And she goes, "Well, it's about this tall, has gray-green leaves like this and little yellow petals." And he goes, "Is this all?" She goes, "Yes." And he goes, "Let's go home." So he starts walking and she's going behind him going, "Ooh, I must have missed something. Gee, oh God, that, this is horrible, I feel terrible." And then the grandfather's uncommunicative the rest of the night. You know, and they get back and they're eating dinner. And she goes, oh God, I hope I get another chance. Oh God, I hope I get another chance. So the next morning, they're eating breakfast. And then he gets his digging stick and his bag and he goes, "Little one, let's go for a walk now." "Good, reprieve, I have another chance, right?" So they go back out to the same plant and he says, "Little one, I want you to sit with this plant and I'm going to go away and then when I come back, I want you to tell me about it." She says, "Okay." So he walks off and she looks really close and realizes the plant has little tiny hairs all over it. And she realizes this must be what she had missed. But then the ant highway is still there. And the butterflies and the rolling down the hill, and she just has a great time, right? And so she sees him coming back, she brushes herself off, she sits down, and he comes up, and he goes, "Little one, what did you see while I was gone?" And she says, "It has little tiny hairs all over it." And he goes, "Is this all?" She goes, "Yes." Let's go home. 7 long days and 7 long nights. So like after a week of this, you know, they get up and they're eating breakfast and she's going, "Not the digging stick. Don't get the, So she goes, "Little one, let's go for a walk." She's like, see, and Lakota children are taught to be very polite, but she's pushing the boundaries as much as she can. And he's pretending not to notice, and they're going out the front door, and her brothers are playing, and she's going, "They're so lucky. I want to do that." And they get out, and he gets to the same plant, and he goes, "Little one, I want you to sit down with this plant." She throws herself down. He pretends not to notice, and then he goes, "I'll be back later." He walks off, and then she sits up, and she goes, "I hate you. I hate you." You know, if hate could kill the plant, it would already be dead. You know, and then she just starts crying. She feels so horrible. She's crying. And she just cries herself out, and then she's so tired, she lays down, and she goes to sleep. And she has a dream. Now, in the dream, she's in the exact same place, but she sees her mother walking toward her over the hills. Very long, beautiful black hair and everything, and the mother gets closer and closer, and the little girl's going, "Oh, at least somebody loves me. At least somebody cares about me." You know, and she's feeling a little better, and then she notices her mother is crying. She says, oh, what's wrong? What's wrong, Mama? And the woman gets up closer, and the little girl looks down and sees the mother's barefoot, and she has little pinprick holes all over her feet and little drops of blood coming out. She's going, oh. And then it kind of fades, and she wakes up. And then she looks over, and her grandfather's coming back, and it's like, yeah, great, you know. And so he walks, she sits up, and she's like, "Ah." And he walks over, and he goes, she goes, don't say it. "What did you see while I was gone, little one?" She goes, nothing. I hate doing this. Why are you making me do this? I hate it." And he goes, "Well, what do you do all day, little one, while I'm gone?" And she goes, "Well, I look at the stupid plant, and then there's the ant highway, and the butterflies, and the hill, and the clouds, and, you know, sometimes I take a nap." "Ooh, do you have a dream?" "Well, I had a dream today." "Ooh, tell me that dream, little one." So she tells him the dream, and he goes, "Ah." So he pulls out his digging stick, and he goes, "Here, Go dig up that plant, little one. So she digs it up and brings it to him, and he holds it in his palms, and he goes, "That was not your mother that you dreamed of, little one. I knew her very well, and she did not look like that." He goes, "Look," and he takes the plant and he brushes the dirt off the root, and it has little pinprick holes in it with little red drops coming out. And he said, "Little one, we use this plant to heal the pain of wounds, to stop bleeding. You did very good today, little one. Let's go home now." Isn't that a great story? The trembling and then the silence. So you can just feel that resonating in the room now. Feels really good, doesn't it? It's possible to feel this way most of the time. These experiences tend to become more myth-like the deeper you go. More brain wobbles tend to occur as well. And this same process occurs in all living organisms. It's part of how Gaia keeps the system functioning. So, I'm going to talk a bit about self-organization. I love getting into this, and I have weird ways of segueing into things like this. So I'll get into it this way. I heard this really hilarious joke recently. So there's this physicist that gets on an airplane, and he sits down next to this girl. She's about 11, and the girl's reading this like advanced ecology text, right? And she's incredibly precocious. So he thinks, oh great, an intelligent companion. I'll strike up a conversation with her. And he says, "You know, do you know what's keeping this airplane up when we fly?" And she pauses in her reading, closes the book on her finger, you know, to keep her space. She turns to him and says, "Well, let me ask you one. Cows, horses, and deer are herbivores. Yet when they excrete, one makes a pat, the second large droppings, and the last tiny pellets. Why is that?" And the physicist thinks for a while, and he goes, "I have no idea." And then so she looks at him and she says, "Well, then why should I engage with you in a conversation about the dynamics of lift when you don't know shit?" See, the thing is, physicists don't know all that much, okay? They're specialists, and they may get into studying gravity. Now, gravity's easy. Most of the stuff that a lot of physicists study is very simplistic. Gravity's a simple thing to study. But they won't know anything about self-organization. And so when you get into self-organization, I mean, it's really the root of why the old system is falling apart. Okay, because everywhere we're going to now, self-organization is showing that the old linear cause and effect rule of things just doesn't work. So it's where it all begins to fall to pieces. Now, there's this guy, a mathematician, Stephen Strogatz. I love picking on this guy. He says, in every case, he says, you know, because the thing is, with self-organization, here's the way it works. You get a bunch of researchers, they get a closed container, and they begin packing molecules in it, okay? Pack, pack, pack. And at some moment that can never be predicted, the molecules will all tightly couple together and synchronize and begin moving as one coordinated whole, right? Something more than the sum of the parts comes into being, right? That's sort of the simplest example of what happens like that. So they're finding this is going on everywhere, right? And Stephen Storgatz says, in every case, these feats of synchrony occur spontaneously, almost as if nature has an eerie yearning for order. And that raises a profound mystery. Scientists have long been baffled by the existence of spontaneous order in the universe. The laws of thermodynamics seem to indicate the opposite. that nature should inexorably degenerate toward a state of greater disorder, greater entropy. Yet all around us, we see magnificent structures that have somehow managed to assemble themselves. This enigma bedevils all of science today. Now you get this thing, almost as if nature has an eerie yearning for order, okay? That says a huge amount about him and the orientation of scientists. You have to understand what eerie means. Strange, frightening, uncanny, sinister, ghostly, unnatural, unearthly, supernatural, right? The world acts in a way which frightens him because his paradigm says the world is a static place. He's using static models. The laws of thermodynamics, and where did the laws of thermodynamics come from? These tablets were handed down on this mountain. No, they made them up based on observations, but their observations were limited, okay? It's his emotional response to a software conflict. His software is inaccurate to the world. I love this, bedevils. Bedevils. It means to torment mercilessly, to plague, worry, annoy, frustrate, to be possessed by devils, to bewitch, to spoil our ruin. It ruined our good time. We knew how the universe worked, and this has ruined our good time. And it's not as almost as if nature has an eerie yearning for order. Nature does have a yearning for order, and it's not eerie at all. Okay. Lake Erie. Ooh, every time I get around that lake, I get scared. Kind of an American joke, sorry. But it'd be like saying, I get around the River Dart and I feel these pointed things. So the problem for science is self-organization is core to this reality, just like gravity, and it has tremendous implications. It undoes linear cause and effect approaches. It unravels the underlying rationale of the entire reductionist approach. It contains irremovable unpredictability. The moment can never be protected. The moment can never be predicted. Self-organization's a phase change. Now look, we get used to miracles all the time. We just don't know that they're miracles anymore. Okay, imagine somebody living in Africa where it never gets down to freezing. Okay, it's always warm. And they're always around water, right? But they've never seen water freeze, ever. Never even heard about it. Okay, for them, they would never be able to conceive of that happening, ever. In their wildest imagination, they could never conceive of that. And so they'd be somewhere and you begin reducing the temperature slowly, just like a tiny little degree above freezing, just a tiny bit, it still won't be frozen, right? Then it goes down below freezing, it's frozen. You get a phase change, water to ice. Not predictable from its earlier state. That's why a phase change in Earth functioning is so dangerous. Not like it's just going to get linearly more hot, okay, which is what the climate change people are kind of into. Well, it's going to get linearly more hot, and you know, the trees won't grow the way they did, and you know, we'll have to wear bathing suits all the time in England, and we can't do that because of our body kind of thing. That's what they're most nervous about, you know. We'll have to all go naked. And then that's the entire, our civilization will crumble. So you get a shift from a one state that seems normal, and it'll be so different you can't predict it. And then all of a sudden, one day we're in within a habitable range, the next day we're not, and it doesn't go back. Okay, that's a phase change. We're amidst of phase changes. They're happening with greater frequency all of the time. Self-organization is a phase change. And at the moment of self-organization, something entirely new comes into being. A new type of organism, it possesses new behaviors. Something more than the sum of the parts comes into being. And you can't find that thing that's more than the sum of the parts in any of the parts. You can dissect it all day long, not going to find it. The guarantee is, however, if you dissect it, you'll never find it again. Okay? So it can't be found or understood with the kind of thinking that we've been doing. Now, Margulis used a term she got from somebody else called autopoiesis, means self-making, the spontaneous appearance of a self-organized entity possessing emergent behaviors. And within this dynamic, you get a different form, but the behaviors happen too, and they both happen contemporaneously. They're simultaneous. To Gaia, behavior and form aren't any different. They're just different aspects of the same thing. Okay? It's kind of hard to get your head around that, that behavior is an identity as powerful as form. So the parts of the whole, all of the subparts, are allopoietic. They're subordinated to the whole. They work to maintain self-organization. And our white blood cells are an example of this. They're self-organized entities that help us maintain our self-organization. Okay? So all of the subparts tightly coupled together to make one self-organized, tightly synchronized whole. The study of the parts will never lead you to that. So physicist Paul Davies says, nonlinear systems possess the remarkable ability to leap spontaneously from relatively featureless states to those involving complex cooperative behavior. An important point as well here is that cooperative behavior is much more fundamental than competition. The Earth ecosystem is primarily cooperative, not competitive. So at the moment of self-organization, the system begins to act as a unit to do things. So again, linear analysis is flawed, and Masanobu Fukuoka captured a lot of this greatly. He goes, the living and holistic biosystem that is nature cannot be dissected or resolved into its parts. Once broken down, it dies, or rather, those who break off a piece of nature lay hold of something that's dead, and unaware that what they are examining is no longer what they think it to be, they claim to understand nature. Because they start out in the wrong place, everything they do afterward ends up all wrong. Okay. The emergence of new form and new behavior in the Gaian system is stimulated by environmental pressures on the system. And those pressures are generally invisible to the eye. There's a pressure, a meaning wave that comes in, and the system begins to adapt itself. And at the moment of self-organization, the organism comes alive. It's like on one side is randomness, on the other side of that line is self-organization, and it always remains really close to that line, close to the edge of chaos. Okay? It's very sensitive there. It retains an exquisite sensitivity to perturbations that can disrupt its self-organized state. Its sensitivity remains very enhanced there. If it moves too far away from that edge of chaos, it becomes rigid, totalitarian. If it goes too far close to it, it can fall over into anarchy. And you see this happens in culture all the time. Cultures move back and forth near that line. If they can find that balance point, they remain vital, but always somebody wants to take it over here, it becomes authoritarian. And then other people get pissed, they wanted to go over the line, and it gets very anarchic. 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 Antarctic means no bears. It's like, now I know how to tell. The Arctic means bears, has bears in it up north, down south. Antarctic, no bears. My mind's a junkyard of useless facts. What's the only mammal that can't jump? An elephant. I mean, that's useless to me. I can't get rid of it. So the system constantly monitors its external world in its internal world for any kind of perturbation that could cause it to lose its self-organized state. And then as soon as that it detects one, it then analyzes its nature, changes its behavior and form to reestablish that balance point again. And this is happening in a constant dance, a constant flux all of the time. And I love talking about juggling as, because it's a great example of that. So, and I always irritate my editor. So she always wants me to take stuff like this out of the book, it's hilarious. I go, well, you have a juggler here and his balls over here.
Yeah.
And so the juggler picks up his balls. I mean, I love doing this because it's really hilarious. The juggler picks up his balls. I mean, you can't help but the image, right? But anyway, he starts going and he starts juggling with, you know. And what happens is at the moment of juggling, something more than the sum of the parts comes into being. If you've ever tried to juggle, you can't do it with your linear mind at all. You have to do it with, you find this balance point. It's like riding a bicycle, kind of, right? So what's happening is they're juggling, and, you know, but the balls never go in the same arc. They're always a little bit off. So they have to, you see them do this, they adjust. But at below the level of consciousness, they're analyzing very quickly the alterations that are occurring, adjusting to it so they can keep the balance point intact. If you had to give a, if you told a physicist, plot that trajectory and say where we need to move the hand, it would take them hours to do that with a linear mind. But a juggler does it just instantaneously. And if you take two jugglers that are completely identical in every way, impossible, but for the sake of argument, they're exactly identical and they both start out, they'll end up somewhere else in the room. They won't end up in the same place because each will choose a slightly different way to reestablish the balance point, right? Free will is always involved in self-organized systems. They all choose from a multiplicity of potential responses to destabilization. This is why it can never be predicted what's going to happen, okay? And this all happens in almost kind of a dream state, okay, below conscious awareness. And this is very specifically why top-down solutions, linear approaches, can't solve the problems before us. Solutions have to come out of this different kind of thinking. All of us have an extremely sophisticated ability to analyze complexity and generate a response. All of you can stand on the street, the side of the street, and there's a truck or a car coming down the road. In just a millisecond, you can look, you can determine how fast it's coming, you know how fast you can walk, and you know whether you can make it across the street, right? A physicist would take hours to figure that out. Okay. Each juggler will always generate unique to themselves solutions. And this is part of the wonder of life. It's just the unique genius of each juggler finds its own solutions. Every organism on Earth is exactly like this, but the complexity is much larger than juggling. All the trillions of organisms that exist are engaging in this kind of choosing every day. Every organism is made up of a nested groupings of self-organized systems, each of them composed of cells. Within each cell, there's over 100,000 things going on at any one time. Okay. Scientists can't even predict what will happen if you get more than 3 billiard balls on the table. But in the cell, there's over 100,000 things. There's all these self-organized subparts, all of them highly intelligent, all of them keeping the balance point. As Barbara McClintock said, every component of the organism is as much of an organism as every other part. And organisms group together to make up ecosystems that contain millions of organisms, all tightly coupled together and functioning as a whole. Each allopoietic part is self-organized. Under the exterior or interior pressure on its balance point, it generates a wide range of possible responses, and then it chooses one from those numbers. So you have millions upon millions of organisms on the Earth making choices all the time, none of which can be predicted. The Earth itself is self-organized as well. It exists continually in the state of mind a juggler is in when it's juggling, okay? But at a much greater degree of complexity. Whenever it senses a destabilization, a pulse of tremendous informational density moves through the system below the level of consciousness, just like juggling. It's a gestalt complex of meaning that contains within it all the necessary information about the input that's causing destabilization. The self-organized subunits that together make up Gaia then respond. They make a choice generated out of their own genius. I mean, think about it. Gaia basically has trillions of highly intelligent computers, is one way to kind of metaphor it, that get fed data and then they generate solutions. It's much more effective than Gaia sitting there going, I wonder what I should do next. The system uses its innate intelligence to analyze and begin generating responses. And Gaia trusts them to do so. And it's like with juggling, the longer Gaia's at it, the better Gaia gets. And Gaia's been at it a very long time. To trust the innate genius of the system, of all of the parts, is quite a leap for reductive people, but that's why my trust is in you, not in experts. Because your own innate genius will find solutions they can't find. I mean, one of my favorite things was reading about how these HIV researchers were, what they were going to do is, they were trying to solve the way a protein, the HIV protein, folded. And they spent 10 years and millions of dollars trying to figure it out. And they finally gave up. And then one of them said, well, why don't we put it on the internet? In 7 days, 300,000 people were working on it, and in 10 days, they solved it. Okay. Which I thought was fantastic. But of course, what the scientists said was, oh, this is astonishing. You know, if we can properly channel these people, so the thing is, as soon as a living organism self-organizes, a neural network forms always, okay? Immediately. So, because as soon as it forms, there's this rapid flow of information coming from outside and from the interior, moving through the neural network, so it can monitor its self-organizational state. And all self-organized biological systems have an interface, a place where they and the exterior world touch, the place where me and not me intersects. And it's the place where information about the exterior world is gathered. So, some neural nets and sensory portals, you know, on that membrane are all of the sensory portals at the interface between me and not me. Some neural networks look like ours, others are different. They all serve the same function. They all have sensory gating. Now, where it begins to get really interesting, and the place where reductionists get really twitchy, you understand, to maintain self-organization, all organisms have to have a sense of me and not me, right? That means they're all self-aware. Because some inputs are dangerous to self-organization, this means they all have to be able to analyze inputs to determine whether they're beneficial or not, and then they have to create a response. Thus, all self-organized systems are intelligent by definition. And, you know, Pythagoras said this a long time ago, astonishing, everything's intelligent. But if you get that everything's intelligent, that we're only a specific instance of a general condition, the whole reductionist worldview begins to crumble. There is no hierarchy of intelligence and value. It's the great hidden truth that they don't want us to see. But it gets even worse. Self-organized biological systems, because they have to be able to determine intent, they engage in a search for meaning just like we do. And it gets still worse. All self-organized biological systems possess a sense of kin, altruism and cooperative group action, language, culture, cultural memory, the capacity for tool making, and a great deal more. Some of them even make cities more complex than our own, including making and using electricity to keep them warm. And they run the electricity through insulated cables, just like we do. You didn't learn this in school, did you? When self-organization, when you really begin to understand it, it becomes clear we possess no attribute that is not already an attribute of the system that gave rise to us. We're subunits of Gaia. Everything here has the same attributes. And I love, you know, at the Oracle at Delphi, they had this thing, everybody's heard the first part of that, know thyself, one of the greatest injunctions for human behavior. But it's actually only the first part of the sentence. Know thyself, and thou wilt know the universe and the gods. Because we are only a specific instance of a general condition. Okay? That's why we can engage in communication with plants and they with us. We both possess language, just not the same kind. But underneath those languages is the capacity to work with meaning. We both encode meaning in specific forms. We both shape it. We have the capacity to work with meaning directly, just as we did when we were first born. So gating in every organism, but let's talk about human beings, it exists across a spectrum. Some people have very narrow gating. Get off my lawn. Other people have very widely open gating, and I'm glad you're here because my example is, I love the blue streaks in your hair. So gating tends to be more open in people on hallucinogens, the gifted artists, people that are more sensitive, schizophrenics, spiritual ecstatics, shamans, indigenous cultures. Oddly enough, sensory gating is the most narrow in the Western cultures of all cultures on Earth. Okay. And of course, grammarians, engineers, reductive scientists, fundamentalists of any sort, whether they're religious or not, have very narrow gating. And when we're born, we have very little gating. The doors of perception are widely open. And as we get used to the physical world, we stop looking at things so deeply, we begin to habituate. And we get taught to shut it down. The interesting thing is, children have very open gating, and they have to be trained to shut a lot of it down. They automatically orient themselves to interiors. They know the world is alive. Children know it. You see them all the time. They'll go up to a plant and they'll go, oh, how are you? Oh, look, it's sad today. Right? And we're trained to grow out of that and not talk about it. But what's interesting is children have to be taught this over and over and over and over again. They will not automatically give it up. And their gating narrows in response, and eventually they end up stuck in the same framework that all of us are struggling with. We're taught when we go to school, from our culture and our family too, we're given a series of templates through which we see the world. We place over the world, we perceive everything through that. To perceive intelligence, we use a search template that we have been taught. And that's the template you use to determine that a person is intelligent and a dog is not, right? Or not intelligent the way that you are. Even though you don't know it, you're using a search template. But think about it. How do you know, really, that a person's more intelligent than a dog? Because you have something inside of you. You're using a comparative that defines intelligence. And you automatically apply it to everything you encounter. It's usually culturally relevant as well. People from your culture are generally considered more intelligent than those from other cultures. I mean, just look at the Germans. I think that's hilarious. I only got 3 laughs, you know? It's like, I have to work on that. There's a couple of jokes I've been telling for like 30 years, and there's like 2 of them. Nobody ever laughs at them, but I won't give them up because I think they're hilarious. I'm not going to stop till you laugh, God damn it. So another example is to perceive a living state, we use a search template, all right? That's how we can tell a rock is not alive and a plant is. So it's a priming. The template primes us to see some things. Okay, now this is interesting. Okay, let's do this, play with this a little bit. All right, let's find some stuff. Okay, look at this right here and focus on the texture of that archway of stone, okay? Just look at the, notice the texture. Okay, notice the texture of the wall above it. Notice the texture of the lamp, okay? Notice the texture of that hanging there. How do you feel? It probably took you a second, didn't you, when I said that? There was probably a moment of confusion because you were oriented to surfaces and it shifted the frame of reference. And for a minute you went, the question, how do you feel, didn't even make sense, okay? Until you shifted and began using a different template. So, I can do this other thing. Oh, I get to use the thing here. Hey, where's my pins? You know, I was like, I was waiting and my pins were stolen. Thanks. Okay, somebody just yell out a word.
Enrich.
That's a good word. Okay, another one.
Mom.
What?
Mom.
Mom?
It's a word.
It is. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure. It is a word, and I'm sure your mother is quite glad that you have that word. Okay, another one.
Daffodil.
What?
Daffodil.
Daffodil. Okay, and I'll put in one like, get out of here. Okay. Does this end in a consonant or a vowel?
Consonant.
Who said a vowel? Go back to school. What the hell's wrong with you? Does this end in a consonant or a vowel? Consonant or vowel? Consonant or vowel? Consonant or vowel? Consonant or vowel? What does it mean?
What's the word?
Timely. Okay, here's one, enrich. But you notice as you go through that, you're focused on the surface, the form, and the same thing happens. If I say, what does it mean? There's the same dynamic as happens with how does it feel. You're using a template that keeps you from noticing the meaning of the thing, okay? So they've done a lot of research about this and they found that what Gregory Bateson said is true. The human being depersonified in his own talk and thought may indeed learn thingish habits of action. The thing is, when you teach scientists and they're focused on form, 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 after a while, if you ask them the question, how does it feel? What does it mean? They can't move out of the system. It interferes with their ability to see the metaphysical background. And we become subliminally primed in our perception by the template that we use. This is why the map that we use needs to be as accurate to the world as possible. Okay. You have to understand there's meaning inside everything that we encounter. Every sensory bit has meaning in it. There's a feeling dimension to it that gives us access to its interior nature. Like musical notes. A musical note is an auditory pulse, but there's a feeling dimension to it that gives us access to the meaning in it. Mahler said, what is best in music cannot be found in the notes. Similarly, every visual input has a feeling dimension inside of it. So let's take it a bit further. Here's some sheet music. Is that the song? No, it's not the song. It's a map of the song. Okay? It's a kind of map. But it's not a very good map. And I'll give you an experience of why. Here's the song. My father always promised us that we would live in France. We'd go boating on the Seine, and I would learn to dance. See, there's something else in the room now. Right? Things changed. There's a feeling. There's a quality of silence now. You all shifted your cognition. That's the territory. This is the map. And that territory that you just experienced part of can't be found any place in here. Okay. Now, to take it a little bit further, the map is the surface. It's not the metaphysical background. But to take this a little further, that's a map as well. And it has the same feeling dimension behind it as that map of the song does. We're taught to work with the surface of it, but it has that same depth of metaphysical background as that song did. If I could draw, I could draw a benzene ring, or I could draw the molecular structure of water, but I'll just do the symbol. Behind that is the same complexity of metaphysical experience as that song. Okay. Most science just stays with the surface, and they miss everything that's really important. But to take it even further, if you look at this plant here, the body of this plant is also a map. Okay? And behind its surface is a living reality like that song, just as powerful in its impacts. But when that song emerged, what you basically got was a feeling. There was a powerful feeling that entered the room. Right? My father always promised us that we would live in France. We'd go boating on the Seine, and I would learn to dance. There it is again. That feeling, something like that feeling will always emerge every time you go behind the metaphysical background and deep into the metaphysical background of the world. You can't genuinely work with the living reality that's behind maps or physical form until you get this is the way it feels, that this is what emerges every time. You go into the territory itself. It's like I'm running out of time. I'm hastening because I had so much to share today, and yesterday I ran out, but I can pick you. Would you mind walking up here? Do you mind being the center of everybody's loving attention? Okay, all right, just turn and look at everybody. Okay, what's your name?
Lauren.
How old are you?
33.
Okay, where were you born?
Wales.
Okay, does this tell you really anything about her?
No.
Okay, you can sit down now. That's kind of a map. So you go into the doctor, they get you weigh this, you weigh that, and they get all that stuff. They don't know anything about the interior of your life. Okay, they just get surfaces. So yes, we are a map too. Right? Now, interestingly, the Bushmen of the Kalahari say, everything has a song. See? They're basically saying, everything is a map, or everything is a score, like that in a sense, and behind everything is a song just like that song. The native peoples of America said, every plant species has a song. Kathleen Harrison, who was married to Terence McKenna for a long time, said this great thing. It's just absolute genius. Every species has a song. They're talking about plants. Every plant species has a song. If you are granted the song in a vision, or by just submitting yourself to the presence of the song and opening up, then it's a real gift. And you're able to remember that song forever and share it when it seems appropriate. That song has power, healing power. And there are some which are handed down from one generation to the next, and there are others which come to us as individuals. Here's the brilliant part. But they are part of an encyclopedia on the sonic level of the same thing that seeds represent on another. They are part of an encyclopedia on the sonic level of the same thing that seeds represent on another. So when somebody was working with healing and they would give somebody a plant medicine, they would sing the song of the plant, which would bring the living reality of the thing into the room, just like my singing my father did. Right? And when the song was sung, the healing went much deeper. It brought the metaphysical background of the plant livingly into the room and blended it into the person's interior world. So paying attention to how each thing feels, like a musician pays attention to the feeling of each note, is the key. See? It's the key to opening the doors of perception, moving behind the form to what is held inside of it. All of us are meant to sing, you know. To participate in the song, to add our voices to the choir. I love what John Seed, the Australian rainforest activist, said. He said, preaching to the choir is the way to go. Because if you get them really inspired, man, can they sing. And the more inspired they are, the bigger the song becomes. And other people wandering by goes, oh, what's that song? I like that song. I think I would like to sing that song too. And then the choir gets bigger, the song gets larger, and pretty soon, lots of people in the world are singing the song. Preaching to the choir is the way to go. You didn't need anyone to teach you how to feel music, right? It's a natural capacity you had and that you do have. It's inherent in you. And I love what the poet E. Cummings once said about feeling. He said, a poet is somebody who feels and who expresses his feeling through words. That may sound easy, it isn't. A lot of people think or believe or know they feel, but this is thinking or believing or knowing, not feeling. And poetry is feeling, not knowing or believing or thinking. Almost anybody can learn to think or believe or know, but not a single human being can be taught to feel. Why? Because Whenever you think, or you believe, or you know, you're a lot of other people. But the moment you feel, you're nobody but yourself. Isn't that great? The moment you feel, you're nobody but yourself. The reclamation of the feeling sense is the ecological reclamation of ourselves. It's the capacity that allows us to interpenetrate the world and for the world to interpenetrate us. We've lost a lot of capacities, but it's still the capacity to feel is inherent in us. One of the great lines I heard once, and I'll work with it more this afternoon, was, I too, like this land, have lost parts of myself. There's an ecological reclamation of the self to become more whole again.